If everybody's got their Bibles, we're going to turn to Matthew 14, verse 28. When everybody's there, just say amen. Okay. Matthew 14, 28. The title of this message is, Faith Got Me In This, and Faith Will Get Me Out. In Matthew 14, 28, and Peter answered him, Lord, if it is you commanded me to come to you on the water, and he said, Come. So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water, and he came towards Jesus. But when he perceived and felt the strong wind, he was frightened as he had began to sink. And he cried out, Lord, save me from this death. And instantly, Jesus reached out his hand and caught and held him, saying to him, O you of little faith, why did you doubt? And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat knelt and worshipped him, saying, Truly, you are the Son of God. I like Peter. Peter was bold. He was a true man of God, but he was also not without fault. And the Lord knew that. The Lord saw something in Peter that most of us see in each other. Peter was an ordinary man. And God chose ordinary men to do his work. And the title of my message is Faith. It took Peter faith to trust God when he called on him. He didn't know how it was going to go. He just knew from his heart that God would save him. I don't know how many people in here struggle with doubt or double-mindedness, but I know I do from time to time. And, you know, when I keep reading the message of Peter, it reminds me, I see Peter within myself a lot of times, and I know y'all do too. When I come into contact with a lot of people and I talk to them about their faith, you know, they're always, you know, explaining to me, well, I can't do this and I can't do that because I got this going on or I've got that or, you know, so on and so on. But for me, just like when I've spoken to the pastor and everybody, each person has taught me faith in this place by their testimonies, by, you know, the things that's happened in their life. Doris, she knows what faith is and what she's had to face in her life. And she's had to get out on that water and walk just like the rest of us. And I'm still walking on that water, and sometimes I'm treading it instead of walking on it with God. But he's teaching me, he's teaching you, he's teaching every one of us about what faith is. He's stretching our faith. And to me, when I think about faith, I think about the times of the things that I've been through. You know, I didn't know how this was going to go tonight because, you know, this is my first time ever standing in front of an audience and speaking God's word. I'm not nervous, but sometimes it's hard to find the words, so I'm leaning on faith. Faith is what we hope for. It's not what we see. It's the evidence. And I know I brought my guitar in because I wanted to share with how I've walked on water as God has taught me to, you know, trust him with my faith. I never knew how to play the guitar. Never had a lesson in my life. But I do remember one time praying. I said, Lord, just like Peter, if you'll save me, then I'll do it. But what I said was, God, if you'll teach me how to play the guitar, then I'll play. Then I'll know that you have called me. I'll know that you have, you know, demonstrated your authority and your power in my life. But it took faith, and it took faith like Peter to step out on the water to do that. It took me trust in God to step out on that water and to pick up that guitar and to practice. It didn't just come natural. It was something I had to work at, but it also took faith. And I'm a man of faith. Every man is given a measure of faith. And that's what the Bible says. And rather than struggle with the message that I've brought here tonight, I think that each and every one of you can look back in your lives and see where faith, where you've had to get out on the water and walk just like Peter and trust the Lord. It doesn't take a dynamic situation or even a message to move your heart to have faith. He said all it takes is the faith of a mustard seed. That's a little faith. That's not a whole lot. And I've had situations in my life where I've been like Peter. I didn't know how it was going to go, but I had faith. And faith can cause miracles to happen. And for miracles, a miracle sometimes to me, well, of course, is like Peter walking on the water. But sometimes it can be as simple as something that God came through for, on you for, or came through to you, or that you witnessed something that God did. To me, that's a miracle. I don't know how y'all perceive miracles. Sometimes there's great miracles. Sometimes there's small miracles. But the greatest miracle that you and I both know was the minute that we received Jesus as our personal Savior. You know, when that song was playing earlier, and I was sitting there and I was thinking about my prayer mother who led me to the Lord. And, you know, I want to share that with you. When I got saved, I got saved when I was 19 years old. And I had to get out on that water and walk because I didn't know what salvation was. She came to me and she said, "Son, you're a lot like us." And I didn't know what she was talking about because I just came to visit. And she invited me to dinner. And that's all I was focused on. But I always liked her company. I always liked the way that she, you know, treated me. I really never had a mother. I lost my mother when I was 8. And my grandparents raised me. But this woman took me under her wing, and she invited me to church. But it took faith for me to trust her and to get out on that water and go to that church. And I got to tell you, that was a trying experience for me because I ain't never been in church. You know, my parents didn't raise me in church. I didn't know what church was. I walked in, everybody was looking at me, and I was like, "What is everybody looking at me for?" And I was looking back at them going, "Well, if you're going to look at me, I'll look at you." But at the same time, I realized that it wasn't them looking at me. It was Jesus looking at me through them. And I was on the water, and I was walking to Jesus. And my prayer mother had enough love and belief in me to bring me there. I knew she was doing God's will. I knew she was believing what God was telling her to do, but I was scared. I was sitting in the chair, and all of a sudden, I remember that night it rained. I mean, it was pouring down. They was having revival in there, and I didn't even know what was going on. I thought it was the craziest thing I ever seen. I seen all these people jumping around, hooping and hollering, carrying on. I was like, "Wow, this is something else." All right. I was feeling a little bit awkward. But, you know, I can remember after the rain had settled, and I was sitting in the chair, and I had one raindrop on the top of my head. And it was, I don't know how it stayed there. And it rolled down the top of my head, down on my face. And at that point, I had heard the message of God. And at that point, I knew God had spoken to me. The pastor gave the invitation, and I got up, and I walked forward. I was scared. I didn't know. My legs was doing the walking. My mind was still back there in the chair. But I started walking forward. And when I got to the pastor, he said, "Son, do you want to get saved?" I said, "Yes, sir." I said, "That's why I'm up here. I don't know what I'm doing, so I just need you to show me how and what to do." And he got down on me, that man grabbed me, and he held on to me, and he was crying. He was crying more than I was, and I was getting saved. But to make a long story short, that was the first time in my life I can remember walking on water. And the boldness that it took for me to get up and to walk down that aisle. And you know what? I was searching. I didn't know. I just felt like before that, I was looking around all the time wondering what was wrong with me. I was getting into behavior books. My mother used to be a teacher. She left some books behind when she passed away on counseling. I started going through them counseling books and trying to figure out what's wrong with me. But when I got saved down at that altar, everything made sense after that. But what I didn't know after that was how to stay saved. And that's when things got a little bit rough. You know, nobody ever told me that they didn't hand me no material and say, you know, welcome into the kingdom of God and, you know, this is what you got to do. I had to find out the hard way because I feel hard after that, you know. But what the devil meant for my bad, God turned around for my good. But back to the message. Jesus said, come, so Peter, go out of the boat and walk on the water. And he came towards Jesus. But when he perceived and felt the strong wind, he was frightened. How many times in our life are we frightened by things in our life that we're faced with when we're trying to walk in faith? I can remember a time when you spoke in the church and you said, I don't know what it was, but I had this song on my heart and I had to get up here, but the devil was trying to shake my faith. And he messed with my voice and I couldn't even sing. But I told God I was going to get up here and sing anyway. And you did. That was the time. I can remember that was a time where it built my faith. God always brings things back to our remembrance. And he does show us things to come. And Willie, I can remember a time when you walked up to me and you said, I just want to do something for you. And that to me was like Peter walking on the water. And Jesus was coming to him and just pulled him up out of the water. And I want to thank you for helping me. I want to thank you. I exalt you in front of God. I exalt my brother in front. I want to thank you for pulling me up out of that water and being like Jesus in my life and helping me. Michael, I want to tell you the same thing. I want to thank you for the times that you've encouraged me when you prayed out there when we were outside and I came to you. You didn't even say, no, I'm not going to pray for you. But you stepped out on the water and you built my faith. You stood right there in the gap for me and you prayed for me. And I want to thank you for that. And everyone, if I don't mention your name, thank you anyway for building my faith and teaching me how to walk on the water by your life, by each and every one of your lives. And I want to thank you, Sean, for being my friend and teaching me what real friendship is and what faith really is. I know you go through things, but you just keep walking on that water, just like Peter. You keep walking on that water. And eventually, you ain't going to sink if you just keep your eyes on the Lord. You keep coming back to church and you keep focusing on God. Remember what I told you before I came here tonight? I'll give you a little bit of taste. I know who I am. I know what I can do in God. Because it's Christ that lives within me. It's not man that lives within me. I'm a new creation. The old things are passed away, brother. I'm a new man. And with that being said, you know, I didn't bring that guitar tonight to coax you. I just wanted to show you that I had enough faith to get out up on the water and bring it in here and show everybody that I know a little bit about playing a guitar. But I know somebody that knows a lot more about playing the guitar than I do. And I want to thank you for the gift that you've shared with me by your faith. And I understand the difference between faith and confidence. Sometimes we have more faith than we do confidence, but we need that confidence to walk on that water. And I believe in you, brother. I believe that you have a very powerful gift, and I believe that God wants to use that gift for his glory, and I believe you'll find freedom in that gift. I don't know everything about teaching and preaching, and, you know, I'm up here doing the best I can, but I'm trying. I got enough faith to get up here to demonstrate and to be God's example, whether I look foolish or whether I look wise. But I want to thank Charles. I want to thank you for your encouragement in my life and always keeping me straight and being a mentor to me. Your life has signified great faith in how you live your life and your moral values and how you teach the word and your convictions and when you convict me. And I appreciate that because it keeps me straight. My gift are many gifts. One of my gifts is a gift of compassion, of understanding and encouragement. I'm not the greatest teacher. I've never proclaimed to be some great anointed man of God. You know, I've always been, you know, moved by the pastors that's been in my life and how the dynamics of their life and how they preach and how they, you know, how God uses them. I've been in a lot of churches. I've seen a lot of people, you know, walk on the water. I've seen a lot of acting, and I've seen a lot of true hearts. And in ministry, sometimes it's an acting show, but God talks about that in the Word, about being actors. He knows who's being real and who's not. He knows who's following the way and who's not. Do I always follow the way? Sometimes I fall short. Sometimes I let fear get the best of me, like Peter, when he was sinking, and Jesus came and pulled him right back up because he was looking at his circumstance instead of looking at God. And I believe we all do that. I believe every one of us do that in our walk, whether we admit it or whether we don't. We let circumstances sometimes overtake us. I know I do. I look at things, when I see something that seems impossible, I'm like, now I can speak his word just like you can. You said with man, things are impossible, but with you, all things are possible. And he's like, well, I hear you, but I need you to show me. I'm like, show you? I just spoke your word. I believe you. He goes, no, you got to show me. You got to trust me. So no matter what you go through, like Peter walking on that water, you got to trust me. You can't take your eyes off of me. You take your eyes off me, you're going to sink. Then I got to go over and pull you out. Because it took faith for you to trust me to get out on the water. It's going to take faith for me to pull you out. And I can remember when I was walking on the water a couple of times when I got hit by a car. I was walking on the road then. I wasn't walking on water. And I sure felt that car, let me tell you. But I can remember a man pulling me out of that water. And that man was Jesus. He allowed me not to die. That wasn't the first time I got hit by a car, by the way. That was my second time. Third time's a charm. I'm praying that never happens. But it took my faith to walk again. It took me 2 years to walk again. It broke my hip. I was 12 years old. I was in Florida. I, you know, was a kid going Christmas trip. Grandmother let me go with her aunt or my aunt to Florida, and we were sailing on a sailboat, and thought it was the best thing in the world. Well, I went on a bridge on the Terra Verde sails where St. Petersburg and Florida, there's a little bridge that crosses there between St. Petersburg and Tampa. Well, I decided this bird was more important than my life. Because that's all I had my eyes on. It wasn't Jesus. I was just trying to get to that bird because I was fascinated. It was a beautiful bird. I don't know what kind it was because after that, all I saw was blue. But when I got hit, it woke me up. And, you know, I wasn't even saved at that time. I was 12 years old, but I still knew who God was. I was being taught. And I want to tell y'all something. When I was in the fifth grade, it took faith like Peter walking on the water for my teacher to teach us the Bible in school. She stood up and she said, by her convictions, she said, I know we got five subjects in here to cover today, But we're going to add one more, and that's the Bible. I'm going to teach y'all the Old Testament, and I'm going to teach you the New Testament. That woman's name was Miss Nichols, and I praise God for her every day, because that was when the seed was sown in my life. I don't know if y'all was in school, if y'all was taught the Bible. I know you can go to Bible school and teach it, but this wasn't Bible school. This was public school. But I thank God for that moment. But it took faith for her to do that. If they'd have known that she'd done that, do you know that she could have lost her job? But it took faith for her to teach us. And I thank God for that. I thank God for every person and every situation in my life where I've had to get up and walk on the water. I used to joke with Charles, and I used to say, "Hey, I lost my job. I lost my car, and I know what I'm talking about." And he'd laugh at me, and he still laughs at me. But in true honesty, I know what that's like. And it took faith to bring me out of that. It took faith to walk on the water to bring me out of that situation. And it took a lot of love from God's people to put me back on the water. There again, somebody pulled me up. And it was Jesus through somebody else. And I guess the point of my message is that you have to have faith all through every situation that you're going through, no matter what it is. If it's a relationship, if it's finances, if it's, you know, reading the Bible, it takes faith to do that. It takes faith to get up and understand it, even if you don't. I know people that come to me and go, "I don't understand how you read that like you do and understand it." I said, it takes faith. You got to get up. You got to get out on that water. And you got to go forward. And you got to focus on the Lord. And I do that every morning. Not that I boast in myself, like Paul said. But I boast in Christ Jesus for giving me the strength to get up. Sometimes I get up at 3 o'clock in the morning, and I don't even want to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm like, why do I go? Okay, I'll get up. So sometimes I got up this morning at 4 o'clock, and it took faith to do that. I could have went back to sleep. I could have said, nah, that's not important. But I know that by my faith and what I'm believing and who am I trusting, which is the Lord, for my life, for my everyday life, for the circumstances that I'm faced with, I'm still walking on that water by my faith. It's by faith that I got up here tonight and walked on the water because Jesus said, come on, man, you can do this. Just like he told Peter, you can do this. You got to find yourself in me. First, you got to lose yourself. Then you can find yourself. So, you know, I know I'm looking at you, but I don't know why. I guess God must be speaking to you. But, you know, just receive whatever God says. I'm not no scholar. I'm not no theologian by no means. I don't hold that caliber, nor do I care to. I just want to love people, and I just want to make people happy. And I want to see everybody in here blessed. I want to see everybody in here. I want to see the chairs filled up, and like it used to be. I used to walk into church, and there would be doggone, you could just, the whiff of the Holy Spirit when you go through the door just like smack you on the face and knock you down. Then you need some faith to get back up. That's the way it used to be where I came from. I mean, I'd walk in the door, boy, and I mean, like a aromatic aroma of wind just knock you down. And you don't see that anymore. I know I don't. I've been to a lot of churches. Maybe I'm, and you know what? It doesn't take a great group or a big group for that to happen. All it takes is a willing heart and that faith to get out on the water and trust God with your heart and with your life. What have you got to lose? I've lost everything. And I don't want nobody feeling sorry because some things I've lost, I'm glad I lost. I'm glad God removed some things out of my life because it's bringing me to a better situation, a better life. But it's taking faith to walk on that water. Been through a lot of loneliness, a lot of exile, meaning, you know, separation. But Jesus went through that, and he said we would go through it too. But it has taken my faith to stand, and it ain't easy. I'm here to tell every one of you, It's not easy. It's not easy walking on water when God says you can. When he said, and you know, the message could go like, well, hey, you just got to believe that if God says you can, you can. For some of you, you already know that. You know what God can do. You've seen God work in your life. I saw Annie this past Sunday, and I looked in her eyes and I grabbed her face. And it was so good to see her, because her faith, she looked at me and she said, if this wasn't as bad as I thought it was. I got this surgery and my back don't hurt at all. And I was like, wow, man, look at that faith, God. She ain't even hurting. And it's good. She was happy. And that brought joy to my life. That gave me strength. I walked out of here. I was like, well, I'm going to tell you right now, that was a faith builder for me. And that made me strong. And I love Annie. She's a good woman. And I'm proud of her. I'm proud of every one of you. You know, some of you I speak to, some of you I don't. It's nothing personal, like I told you before. I'm just like you. I'm no different. I have the same faith that you have. I bleed the same blood. We all bleed red. There's no prejudice here. There's no, you know, when you love God, why should there be? You know what I mean? I was the only white dude in the black church back in the day when I was in Union County. I stepped in that church and then people looked at me like I was crazy. I walked in there and I said, well, I'm here for one reason and one reason only. You can either like me or you don't have to like me. And my brother that was one of the deacons that got sworn in the church and he got anointed as one of the deacons, they pray over him there. You know how they do it old school. And he always stood up for me. When there was people looking at me and they're going, what's he doing in here, that white guy? What is he do? I was like, whoa. Well, and he was like, you come. He was sitting right up on the front row in front of the pastor or behind the pastor. And I was sitting there I was over there. I felt like I was getting ready to get stoned like Stephen. I was like, I don't know what's going on. And he said, but like Jesus, he said, Peter, come here. I'm going to come over here and I'm going to pull you up out of the water. Sitting there, and they was all looking at me. He invited me to go sit behind the pulpit with all the ministers and sat me down right beside. He goes, you'll sit right here with us in the best seat in the house. And I said, thank you, brother. Thank you so much, because I thought I was going down out there. But he said, no, Spencer, we love you. We understand. He goes, but you got to remember one thing. Everybody don't have the same faith that we do. Everybody's still learning and growing in this church. And we got some brothers that are hating brothers up in here. So you just icing on the cake, no pun intended. And I was like, you're right. You're right. And I thank you for that. But he would always come to me with his faith and strengthen me. I met him in a bank. He was cleaning a bank. And him and another pastor. And they must have saw something in me. To be honest with you, I don't really know how we met. It was an act of God. But from that point, I loved that church. I loved the singing. I loved the soul and the Holy Spirit and the fire that was in that church. It was fire. I ain't talking illuminating light. I ain't talking about Shekinah glory. I'm talking about far beyond now. I'm talking about fire. I'm talking about when the pastor walked by and he rubs you and you feel fire like a flame going. Oh, I'm telling you the truth. That's what happened to me. That's what kept my faith built up. That's what kept me going back for more. You know, when you go back to the table and you want that second piece of chicken because the first one was so good, you got to have another piece. That's the way it was. When I showed up in that church, I was like, I came hungry. I walked in the front door with a knife and a fork and it was like, what are you doing with the knife and the fork? I was like, I came hungry. I'm hungry. I want something to eat, you know. A little sense of humor there, but bottom line is that, you know, even today, and I can tell you this, I wrestle with double minus when I pray with God or when I pray to God and I ask him for something or I ask him to do something and he tells me the answer that I don't want to hear, then I still keep praying. Well, God, have you made your mind up about that yet? I told you already. You know, you keep praying. Or when he tells you something and you just have trouble believing it because you think it's you instead of him. I know we all struggle with that, especially when it's something we're really believing for, a really desiring in our heart. And he knows that. But I do stand on one word that he said in Psalms 37, verse 4. It says, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will grant you the desires of your heart. I believe that there's no mistake about that word. It's all about your faith. I was telling that to Sean before we came here tonight. I said, it's all about your faith, man. And I said, you just need a little confidence. We all need a little push. We all need a little faith. The old pastor, he said, faith lift. You know, like a facelift. He'd say, faith lift. We all need a little faith lift. All the women in the church were smiling. It's like, yeah, I need some facelift. You know? He said, no, I said faith lift. But anyway, the message that I'm speaking tonight, I hope that it builds your faith and that it increases your walk with God. I'm still learning my gifts in God. This was an opportunity for me to get up to glorify him, and that's all I want to do. God knows every one of our hearts. He knows what faith we have and what faith we lack. But if it wasn't for all y'all, I wouldn't have the faith to even walk on water. When I first came here to this church, I was searching. I didn't know what I was going to do or what I was going to say. I was just hungry. I just came. I used to sit back there on the back, and he always would be watching me. Hey, Spencer, good to see you again. And God used this man that he used to be friends with to bring me here, and I kept saying, well, I go to Cathedral of Praise. He goes, yeah, but have you considered Bob Tilton's church? I said, who's that? He said, come on, I'll show you. But it took faith and getting out on that water to come here. Now I'm not sitting back there on the back. Now I'm up here for tonight anyway. And how it goes after that, like he said, you never know. You might throw me out, lock the door. I don't know. But I can remember when the pastors that I came up with, not that I'm a pastor, I'm saying that I was under and that I would learn from, they were given, like, I think 15 minutes to get up and speak their message, and it would be three pastors before they vote and choose the one that was supposed to be the pastor of that church. I don't know if it's like that now. Thank God it ain't. I'm glad you started your own church, because they can't vote you out. But that's the way it was where I came from. He's like, you got 15 minutes. You better get with it. And, you know, some guys, they're shaking. I got to, you know, this is my one opportunity. I don't look at it that way. I look at it as like, if you do your best and you have enough faith to get up here, who knows what's going to happen? Who knows what God's going to do? But I believe with all my heart, with the gifts that I've seen in this place, that there's a lot of faith in here that keep these four walls standing. It's not the foundation. The foundation is Jesus, of course, and you. You are that foundation that holds these walls up. That light may be falling down for a minute, but it's going right back up. Right? Kind of like our faith. Going right back up. We come in re-energized, and then by the time we leave here, our faith is right back up. We're ready to go out there and face another day of whatever, the office or somebody, you know, with a bad mouth or whatever the case may be, you know. I really do appreciate y'all letting me get up here and speak my faith. Like I say, I'm still learning and I'm still growing. I'm comfortable in certain areas of my gifts, but God's teaching me how to, like he said, to step out. And I believe that's why I'm up here tonight, just to demonstrate that faith and standing on that water. There's some bigger things in my life that I'm believing for. There's some bigger things in my life that I'm looking towards, and I'm believing by faith that I'm going to do those things for God in his time. And I'm believing that for y'all too. I'm believing, you know, that there's going to be more people that will come here and that are really hungry and seeking what we came in here seeking ourselves at one time when we were broken and still find ourselves broken at times. I'm still getting broke, you know, but I'm thankful that I'm getting broke because that means that I'm still in his will And I still have that faith to believe and trust Him when He calls me to do something like tonight. And I thank You for the opportunity, Pastor, for me to get up here and to share my faith and to just to keep going. And I pray every day for every one of you. Pray that God would bless you, and that He would. That He would keep you in perfect peace. Thank you, Jesus. And keep you in perfect peace. It's not I heard something the other day that made so much sense, because I was just talking to God. I was like, when I talk to God, sometimes it's, hey, man, you don't understand what I'm going through. You know, it's not, oh, praise you, God. You're so awesome. You're so mighty. I have my times when I do that, but usually it's a characteristic of, hey, man, do you think maybe you could just help me for a minute? I don't know if y'all have ever been there. And I wonder what He thinks about that. And then when I look in the mirror at myself doing it, then I stop it. I'm like, God, boy, you look really... Now I know how He looks at you, because I can see you. I can see yourself. And I'm sitting there like, whoa. And then, you know, I wanted to share something else with y'all that I do a lot of times. Because I ain't got nothing to hide. I'm a Christian. And I'm proud of it. But there's times where I'll be talking to Him and going down the road, and then I'll forget what I'm saying to Him. And then it wasn't really that much important. You know why that happens? Because that's how quick He can change your mind. And He's like, hey, son, you don't need to worry about that. That's not even important. What's important is that you know that I love you. I know you're going through things. I know that I got to test you. I got to try you and test you. Nothing tried, nothing tested. Nothing purified. I don't like it a lot of times. I'll be honest with y'all. I don't like what I go through. Some of it's by choices and decisions that I've made in my past that I've had to deal with. And some of it, I just don't know. It's like I've heard a pastor say, you're going to get up underneath your bed one day and you're going to have days where you don't know what's going on, and you're going to look up at God and go, I don't know why I'm up underneath the bed. And I don't know what's going on. But we're going to have those days. But I really appreciate y'all. I love you so much. Thank you so much for allowing me to get up here. I'm not a sitcom, whatever you call it, comedian. But it feels good to make somebody laugh. You know, when I see you laughing, then I know I'm doing something right, at least. You know, even if it is making a fool out of myself. But He said we make fools out of ourselves for His sake, right? We're fools all the day long for God. I know I am. But I'm still learning and growing. And I think the biggest thing of my life, if you get to know me personal on a one-on-one basis, like some of y'all have, that, you know, you'll see a different side of me. You know, we all have different personalities. We all have different ways about us. But the one thing that we all have in common is love, God's love. And when we have that, we can't lose. I ain't lost yet. I'm still standing. I'm still standing. I'm standing in the gap. I'm standing strong. I'm praying for every one of y'all. I'm praying. I'm preaching while I'm praying at home. And I got one audience, and that's God, because He's the only one that's going to listen to me anyway. So I do that in my personal time. Well, you ought to hear me sometimes. I sound pretty good. But I praise God for you, and God bless you. Thank you for the opportunity to get up here and to share His message. I hope you've been blessed tonight. But just remember, whatever you're going through, just keep walking on that water and just stay focused on Jesus. And I think y'all know what I'm saying. Just keep coming to church. Keep enduring, even if it's for a season. In and out of season, keep doing good. Because He promised us if we do good in and out of season, that we'll reap a harvest that's good and plenty. Your harvest may not be this season, it may be next season or the next, but it will come. I've seen it come. It's like I was telling my brother earlier, nothing ever stays the same. Things will change eventually if you just hold on and keep believing and keep walking forward. And whatever he tells you to do, just do it. I'm living proof. He asked me to do this. Whether I was prepared or not, I wasn't even thinking about it. I just said, okay, I'll do it. You know, Lord, I'll do it. This is who I am. I can't change who I am. This is who God made me to be. And I know he's not finished yet. He's still molding and shaping me. And he's doing it through y'all, and he's doing it through a lot of other people that are in my life. And I just want to thank him for that, and I just want to thank him for this opportunity. And God bless you.
Glory. Hallelujah. Where's my chair at? I'm okay. Woo! Wow. Think of all of the hidden talent in the body of Christ. And my whole life has been to draw people out where they could glorify the Lord and use the gifts that God has given to them to bless the body of Christ and help the body of Christ to grow and mature. Hallelujah. What you got?
I was coming to help you, but you got revived. But Sean, you know, that was a blessing to us. And I know you have your doubts about yourself, but see, sometimes you'll keep yourself from blessing somebody else. Going forward, don't hesitate on blessing people. You have a talent that brings joy to people, and you can do it. Don't ever doubt that you can't do what God has gifted you to do again. Okay? I'm speaking encouragement to you right now. That you be bold going forward. You don't have to be prodded anymore. Just step on out there and do it. And when you think you can't, just think of us again. Just look at our faces again and the smiles that were on our faces. I can do it. And that goes for all of us, because we all hold ourselves back a lot of times. God wants to use us to bless somebody, and we, I don't know, Lord. I'm a little scared about that. I'm not good enough. I can't do it. We can do it. It's better to try to please God and fall right on your face than to not do anything at all. I'd rather fall on my face for God than to just sit down and not do anything. So that spoke to us, and we want to encourage you going forward. Just get up and sing and bless people.
Hallelujah. And come on, you want to? I just want to say this, that it's just like when our sister sings, the anointing is there. And we want to encourage you, not just the singing, but see, the anointing that destroys the yoke. God's given you that gift, but he's given you the anointing to go with that gift. And the devil will do everything he can to keep you not to function for the glory of God, for the body of Christ. It's just like our sister, when she sings, she brings the anointing. And all of our singers are that way. The anointing. And this is what's going to say, I almost fell over. I mean, anointing was on. It's on me right now. I'm going to give it a little bit to you, honey. There you go. Just receive it right now. Lord, I thank you for that anointing. Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo. Lord, I guess she's going to sing or say something, but Lord, whatever, she's going to do it. Woo.
I don't really want to sing. I don't really want to sing because I feel you. When I first got to the Shield, I was on the back row, just like Spencer. And I came from a church where I was on the choir since, you know, we call them the Sunbeam Choir. So that's, we down here. So singing all my life. And then I just sat down. And then when I got to the Shield, oh, the bubble. And so when praise and worship, oh, I was on the ceiling back there. I mean, sweating hard because I'm having a party. And so as I was just singing there, just flowing in the spirit, Ms. Rosemary said, it doesn't sound like you need to be back here. It sounds like you need to be on a mic. And I've been from behind a mic or in a group. I'm always in the choir, but I never wanted to do solos. I don't do solos. I don't like them. And the devil knew it. And so, slowly but surely, she told Linda, take Yolanda, would you? So Linda pulled me to the mic. So we started with sharing the mic. And then someone left, so I ended up on a mic. And it's okay. And then one day, the Lord said, do this song. And I'm like, who, me? Sister don't do solos, you know? I'm always in the back of the choir. I'll be your backup. The first day I did the solo, I had to, can you imagine talking to yourself and singing a song? It's kind of hard. But that's what I was doing to get through the song. And if some of you remember, I never went back to my seat. I went out the door because I was literally about to get sick. That's just how much the devil had me bound up with singing a solo and being obedient to God. So I know where you are. I'm still kind of there, but I said, okay, I'm dealing with sinus issues, and with sinus issues, there's a coating in your throat. And I don't know if you ever tried to sing with it, it will literally choke you. The devil used that. And so every time God placed that little bubble, and I'm sitting back there, and pastor's saying something, and the spirit is high, and I have a song for every little thing he says. So I find myself, I'm singing a song, pastor says something, and somebody said something about ordinary people. I'm back there sitting by Linda. I'm like, ordinary people, God uses ordinary people. It's a song that we used to sing back in the day. And so I so know where you are, to the point to where now I don't even trust myself or give any room to the devil. I just tell pastor, when you want me to sing, just say sing. Because if you leave it to me, I'm going to sit right there in that chair and be disobedient to the nudging of the Holy Spirit that's telling me to sing a song. And then somebody misses the blessing. Because later on, somebody's going to say, hey, you know, such and such was going on. And that very song that could have ministered to them, I sat on in disobedience, in fear, and doubt, and lacking the courage and the confidence to trust God when he gives me that nudging to get up and be bold for the kingdom. So don't miss out on your blessing. I was ready to float out the seat when you just let go and let God give you that courage to play your song. Even afterward, when Pastor Bob was talking, I just felt it. It was just so amazing. So I so know where you are. When Pastor says, Yolanda has a song, I'm like, I didn't, but I guess I do. And I keep my hymn book because you can't ever go wrong with a hymn. The hymn is your foundation. You can't build a building unless you got the foundation. Try to put up the walls and you don't have that floor done. See what happens. You can't go wrong with a hymn, so I keep the hymn book. Keep the hymn book. If you're going through something, find a song to bring you out, and God will give you that courage when you need to. It doesn't matter. I done had the ugly praise phase through a song, okay? You know, water running down my eyes and out the nose, you know? So hello, but it's for God. It's for God. You're not doing anything for man. When you get past man, I tell you, I don't look at it. In the beginning, I didn't look at anybody. I couldn't do it. I wouldn't be able to get the note out, so I would look at the ceiling, look somewhere else, and then eventually, or just close my eyes. But eventually, you know, a little more. The more you do it, the more you do it, the more you do it. Here it is. I can look at somebody, and I can look at Willie, and I'll be trying to contain myself because Willie looked like he about to tap dance on the floor or something like that, or he's doing his little bop or Charles, or, and then sometimes you got to just not focus on him because you feel so light, and then you know you be done forget where you, what you, hold up, you supposed to be singing, you know? When I sing, y'all don't mind me now, because see, I used to do the two-step for the devil, but I do it for God now. So when y'all see me dancing, it's all right. I only dance for Jesus now. I don't club. I don't do the other stuff. It's Jesus. See, if you can do it for man, if you can do it for the devil, when you came to the kingdom, it's no holds barred. Do it for God. If you breathing, you praise him. You praise him in the sanctuary. You praise him in the car. Anytime. If you can sing at home, you can do it. You can do it. He'll give you the strength. I'm a witness. So you keep on. Keep on trying. And it doesn't matter if you mess up a note or you miss the word. They're not paying attention to that. And those who are, they miss the mark. You ignore them. You pray for them because that's not what it's about. Because I even told somebody, oh, my goodness, I changed the words, and I got the hymn book right here in my hand. But that's how full I was, and I was so nervous till I was like, okay, calm down. God has you here for a reason. You can do it. And then I settled myself. And all of this is taking place while I'm singing now. The ability to multitask is very dangerous sometimes because it can have you. I mean, I'll be telling myself some things while I'm singing. I'm like, you got to get through this. It's okay. You can do it. You can do it. And you can do it. Keep doing it. Trust God. Even if you can, I have gotten up there, started a song, and got so full of the Spirit, I just, the audience will back you. They're God's people. They'll back you and encourage you in your silence. It's okay. But get up when he says get up. You do it anyway. Whether you just strum one song and say, Jesus, it's okay. Jesus, you were obedient and you got up. You do it. You have it in you. He placed it in you for a reason. And he's right there with you. He just wants you to break out of the shell. Break out of the shell. He gave you the tools to break out of the shell. Now come on out the shell and stand up and do it for him. You can do it. Pastor helps me do it, so he'll help you.
Yeah. That's right. Thank you so much. Amen. And thank you, Spencer, for what you did tonight, and thank you for breaking the shell a little bit for our brother back there. And he's in there breaking that shell because he's coming forth. Amen. I love every. How many's been blessed tonight? Let's say we're all blessed.